northern hemisphere, something that I've been that I've seen through the week and in previous workshops. I thought maybe I put together a bit of the most recent on the history and evolution of the intraseasonal variability studies in the southern hemisphere and in South America.
Advancing
snows. Okay. So as I say, I will first point out some southern hemisphere climatological features that we may need to keep in mind when analyzing the southern hemisphere circulation patterns on intraseasonal timescales. Those would be mainly the southern annular model, Antarctic oscillation, and then also the Pacific South American patterns. Then we'll discuss a bit about the Rossby wave source and meridional propagation in the southern hemisphere respect to different seasons. And then we'll just focus on South America, mention a bit of the southern South American monsoon circulation, and then the intraseasonal variability of South America. So one of the things that I wanted to point out before we start was the seasonality of the southern hemisphere jet streams. This is from the ERA Atlas, taken from the 200 hectopascal level. And then you see that during southern hemisphere summer, which is DJF, we got this this subpolar jet stream, mostly over the southern Atlantic and South Indian Oceans. And then moving towards the southern hemisphere winter, we also get this very intense subtropical jet in this level, mostly covering the southern Indian Ocean, Australia, and the eastern Pacific Ocean. And we also get this subpolar wave drain here, most to the south. And this feature of the splitting of the wave drains in this region is going to be very important to analyze the propagation of Rossby wave drains there. And you can also see that during the autumn season and spring season, you still get the signal of the subtropical wave, jet stream. So the other feature that I want you to keep in mind is that in the southern hemisphere, we get these convergence zones, the South Pacific convergence zone, South Atlantic convergence zone, and also the South Indian convergence zone. They're mostly present during the southern summer. Here you see the South Atlantic convergence zone using the OLR for the summer. And you see this diagonal band of convergence in the South America, also in the South Pacific zone crossing the Eastern Pacific Ocean. And the South Indian convergence zone is located here. It's a bit more weak and not as intense as the other two convergence zones. And during winter, you see that there is no South Atlantic convergence zone in South America. And you can still see some signal of the South Pacific convergence zone that is mostly there throughout the year. And also you can't see a convergence zone in the Indian Ocean. So about the southern hemisphere circulation patterns in middle to high latitude, we first get as the leading pattern the southern annular mode, also known as Antarctic oscillation. This is computed as the leading EOF of 700 hectopascal geopotential heights. You see that there is a negative anomaly of geopotential height in the Antarctic region and positive anomalies to the north with three different centers. One over the South Atlantic, another in the South Indian Ocean, another in the Eastern Pacific Ocean. This is known as a positive phase of the southern annular mode, and it will enhance the westerlies in this region. So a positive phase, you get an anticyclonic anomaly here, and then the westerlies in the region will be weakened. If you project the daily data over this UOF, you can get the daily AAO or daily SAM index as it's, sorry, I lost my, as you can see here. And it is, this is for the around the last 3 months. And you see that there are some slow variation there, maybe in the intraseasonal timescale, that you can also see if you do a power spectrum of the index, that you get some peaks of variability around 57 days, and also around the 30 or 40 day band of variability. So this can be one important mode of intraseasonal variability in the southern hemisphere. The southern NMO is not only seen is seen across seasons and also across time scales and in the vertical levels. It's mostly a barotropic structure. This is an example for southern hemisphere winter, and if you perform the EOF analysis over the 700 hectopascal height, that is what we see in the last slide. You can also do it in upper levels and the lower stratosphere, and you still get this type of annular mode with a bit of differences in intensity of the centers, but you still get this annular mode signal, not only when you do it on unfiltered data, but also when you do it in transitional band and also in larger interannual time scales. So there has been studies that have related this southern annular mode to the intraseasonal variability. In this case, this is a work by Leila Carvalho from 2005. And she studied for the southern hemisphere summer the positive and negative phases of the SAM index. And they performed composite anomalies, composites using filtered OLA anomalies in the band between 20 and 70 days, and they identify positive and negative southern annular mode phases using this daily index and using the days when the index surpassed one standard deviation for more than 4 days. So then they define the onset of some negative phase or positive phase, which is stated here as day zero, and then they perform these lag composites. And what they said to find was this evolution of negative OLA anomalies in the tropics related to the onset of a sun phase, a negative phase in this case, and a different pattern when they get a positive sun phase, but also seeing a signal of convection there in the tropical oceans. And they also pointed out in this work that the phases of the southern annular mode, they changed the latitude along which the cyclones propagate. This is because of this westerly or enhancement of weakened, depending on the phase of the sun pattern. There has also been studies, I think it was from Paul in 2010, that they didn't find a relation between the southern annular mode and the MJO. But then these other studies said that was mainly because they use the whole year data together. And in this case, what they did in this study from 2013 is that they related the SAM index with the MJO phases, but separating the analysis in the two seasons of the southern hemisphere, some extend the winter and then one extended summer. And they saw that here in this figure, see the fraction of days per phase of the positive AAO index in red and a negative AAO index in black. This is for the southern winter. And they found that there was a more frequency of days of positive index during the MJO phases, maybe 1 and 2, 3. And then there was a less activity of the positive phases during the MJO phases 4 to 8, which is actually opposite to what they found in the extend the summer season, when they see that MGO phases 6 to 8 maybe have more frequency of positive AAO indexes than these 1 to 4 phases. And you see that this relation is opposite, and that might be canceling out the effects if you take the whole season, the whole year together. One other thing that they found is that there was a significant contribution of MGO to the SAM tendency, which be the change over a day of the index. And on the intraseasonal timescale, and especially for strong MJO episodes. So the next two circulation patterns in the southern hemisphere is this one were mentioned before, are the PSA patterns or Pacific South American patterns. They are the UF2 and 3 of circulation. In this case, they are taken using the 200 hectopascal Leydig string function. This is a work of Moan Higgins in 1998 for Austral winter. And you see that these patterns are mostly wave frames with wave number 3 structure that are along the South Pacific Ocean and then move towards the northeast in South America. And during winter, there's a particular feature that you get this also subtropical signal, which is opposite at the same longitude for the subpolar region. They also say that these patterns were found when you take the low frequency band from 10 days and larger periods, and also when restricting it to the intraseasonal band. So they have been related also in interannual timescales to ENSO features. And the intraseasonal timescale, in this case, they analyze it and relate it to tropical convection. They also pointed out that the main periods are around 36 to 40 days, but they also signal around 17 days in this type of patterns. And they also show the classical evolution of these wave chains that this propagation will be coming from a positive PSA1, then a positive PSA2, then a negative PSA1. So they show it like a propagation of the waves. A couple of years later, in this study of 2001, they computed the PSA, but pulling all seasons together. And this would be the EOF, using also the stream function in 200 hectopascals. And in this case, for they took only the DJF season of this of the principal component associated to this pattern, and they perform composites using the intraseasonal filter OLR and the 200 hectopascal stream function. So in this case, they define the onset of a PSA event using the PC1 and when the PC1 surpasses the 1.2 standard deviations, or it was below negative 1.2 standard deviations. So here in this composite, this would be for the OLR and this for the stream function. The onset of the event would be around these lags. This is from day minus 2 to day plus 2. You can see here in the stream function that it should be similar to this PSA1 pattern with positive anomalies here in the region of Australia, the negative positive anticyclonic anomalies here, then cyclonic, anticyclonic, and cyclonic anomalies here. So this should be the circulation. And this type of pattern, you see that they affect not only the southeastern South America region, but also further to the north. And when they performed light composites, they also found that there was a region of enhanced convection in the tropical oceans that was moving from the Indian Oceans towards the Pacific Oceans related to the evolution of this pattern. So they linked in summer also this pattern to tropical convection. And particularly see that the equator is here in this figure and then here in these figures. So it could be related that the convection here to this anticyclonic circulation at the same longitude, and then the Pacific South American wave train extending to South America. So we've already seen quite a bit about this in this lectures about the Rossby wave source. And as the lecturers pointed out, when you divide the source term of the Rossby waves into these divergence component and the advection components by the divergent wind, then you can extend this Rossby wave source into the extratropics when the propagation is more when the propagation extends and it's easy for the wave to propagate. So this is the term that I was talking about. This would be the advection by the divergent wind of the absolute vorticity. It is divided between the mean state and the perturbations. And in this case, this was a work, I think, from Greenman, I think Silva Diaz in 1995, that I recall here in this other study. And what they did was they computed the source term of the Rossby wave, so when they only consider convergence and divergence in the tropics from the divergence term only. In that case, you see that the Rossby wave is mostly located near the tropics. But then when they use this whole expression for the Rossby wave, so you see that the Rossby waves extend to the exotropic regions when they can also propagate. So this is a work from 2011 of Shimizu and Cavalcanti, and they computed the average of in each season for the Rossby wave source term, in this case taking last the diversion of the product between the divergent wind and the absolute vorticity. And so that allowed us to see the main mean Rossby wave sources in the southern hemisphere across the seasons. Focusing first in South America, you see that here in the SACS region, or the South Atlantic Convergence Zone region, is a region of Rossby wave source during the summer. And this region has been related to exciting Rossby wave trains that move towards the African region and then modulate precipitation there in intraseasonal timescales. I won't be talking about that in my lectures, but there were several studies relating convection here to impacts of precipitation in the African region. You can see that there is no wave source in the South Atlantic convergence zones in winter when it's not there. Then it's really reduced during the autumn and spring. You also see that the South Pacific convergence zone region might be a region of generation of Rossby wave trains during the whole seasons. Okay, but we don't only need a source of the Rossby wave trains, but we also need a proper condition for them to propagate. So in this case, what I'm showing is, again, the zone of wind mean for each of the four seasons, and also the meridional gradient of absolute vorticity as using the barotropic theory of Rossby waves. Here you have the total stationary Rossby wave number. That's stationary if you consider that there's no velocity of the waves. And then if you, for the wave to propagate, this should be greater than zero. And particularly this should be, this coefficient should be positive. So in these figures we get this, we see that mostly the wind is positive here. So here's the scale, so violet values. Purple values are all positive. But then you have some regions, mostly in winter, when you get a negative meridional gradient of absolute vorticity in the southern hemisphere, and related to this splitting of the jet region. So propagation can be produced across this region in winter, and it's still there during the autumn and spring season, but really reduced. So this is another important feature for the southern hemisphere winter about the propagation of the Rossby wave trains in the region. This is also a work from 1995 that Nicholas has given us a really updated version using the influence functions that are used to detect where the divergence signal in the winds may be influencing more a certain region. In this case, it was a barotropic model, and using a target point in the South Atlantic convergence zone region, they found that the region where it could be exciting those wave trains might be coming from the Central Pacific region or the SPCC region, slightly displaced to the east. So, Nick. He gave a lot of updates in the previous talk. So following this circulation characterization of the southern hemisphere, now we're going to focus in South America. This is the continent, and the colors show that the population density, as they showed before in the first talk. And so this would be the southeastern South America region that we mentioned in the future. The South Atlantic Convergence Zone region, and also the Northeast Brazil region. that we also had some talks in the previous days. So the main countries involved here are Argentina, where I came from. So here would be Buenos Aires, which is my city. Then Uruguay, Brazil, Paraguay, and Bolivia. And why is this important? Because in this southeastern South America region, there is a major river basin, which is La Plata River Basin. This is the La Plata River here. And not only is this one of the most highly populated regions in eastern South America, but it's also the largest food and crop producers in the region. Agriculture, livestock, fishing are also important activities here. And also, they have 75 dams for hydropower generation in all the rivers contributing to this basin. So not only analyzing the interseasonal variability of rainfall in this region is important, but also they are really pushing us to analyze the subseasonal forecast for the region and monitoring also not only prediction, but also monitoring tools for the interseasonal variability of precipitation here. So the rainy season is mainly modulated by the South American monsoon system. Here you can see the with the winter in the middle, the bars showing the precipitation monthly cycle in South America. This figure is taken from a region around here. And in this region, you can see precipitation covering this broad band in the tropical South American region. And as you can see, there is mostly a rainy season between October and November and March, April. So here you see the maximum precipitation centered in Southern Hemisphere summer. And you can also see that type of variability here, moving more closer to the equator, you see from October to April, that is the maximum rainfall variability time. And just to illustrate this, here is an animation of the OLR and 200 hectopascal streamlines showing the evolution across the year of convection. So here you'll be starting the spring and moving into summer, you get this convection move towards the center of the South Hemisphere continent with this South Atlantic convergence zone here. It's also characterized by an anticyclonic circulation that is here seen over Bolivia, is here, that moves again with this enhanced convection during summer. And then during this, the South Hemisphere winter, this convection moves to the Northern Hemisphere. So the main features of the South American monsoon system, here you have the DJF precipitation and low level winds, and the upper level winds with precipitation that's taken from trim for the DJF season and the JJA season, summer and winter. And you see here the South Atlantic convergence zones shown by the precipitation. And in the upper level winds, you can also see this anticyclonic circulation that was mentioned, it's called the Bolivian high, associated with this pattern. And you also see here the Northeast Brazil low, or the Northeast Brazil trough. That are one of the main features of the South American monsoon system. The main driver of this monsoon system is the differential heating between the South American and the Atlantic Oceans. And you also have the Andes Cordillera here at the west portion of the continent that also contributes to this monsoon system. So with all that in mind, I'll start discussing a bit about the interseasonal variability in South America. This was one of the first studies by Nogués, Pagel, and Mo in 1997. And in this case, they applied rotated UOF analysis for interseasonal filtered OLR anomalies, in this case, taking interseasonal band as 10 to 90 days. And in this number 5 UOF for the Southern Hemisphere summer, they found this a dipole between the variability in the South Atlantic convergence zone region and the southeastern South America region. And also using the principal component as the daily time series, they perform composites and relate these OLR anomalies here in the associated to the Rio F5 to tropical convection. So this was one of the first studies pointed that out. It was mentioned previously, this study by Liebman and others in 1999 for the Southern Hemisphere summer. In this case, they analyzed the sub-monthly variability taken from 2 to 30 days. And they performed also composites using the SACS activity taken from the OLR. And what they found is that in the evolution of this SACS region, here you can see from today before a wave train coming from the extratropics towards the northeast region in South America. And in the leading edge of this cyclonic circulation, then you get this enhanced convection that points out to the SACS activity. So this would be for day zero when convection is mostly enhanced here. The cyclonic circulation is most intense, and the wave train propagates to the north. In this case, they found that the disturbances coming from the extratropics are nearly equivalent barotropic in the west of South America, but they tilt westward with height in the region close to the SACS. And when they perform composites using the whole hemisphere, they could see that there was some path of Rossby wave energy coming from the mid-latitudes. Here's the New Zealand region towards South America. So they might be affecting the mid-latitudes, generating this SACS activity during Southern Hemisphere summer. A most recent study by Van der Ville et al. In 2015, that was also mentioned before. In this case, they studied the timescale of periods below 20 days, and they performed an EOF analysis in this region, covering mostly the SACS region. They found that their leading pattern was always a dipole between the southeastern South American region and the SACS region. In this case, you have the OLR anomalies shaded, the vector wind, and also this will point, the contours are vorticity. And what they found out in this study when they performed this lag composite also was that these extratropical wave trains coming from the Southwest Pacific towards South America. When what they wanted to study was how does this South Atlantic convection zone diagonal features form. And what they found was that using the Rossby wave barotropic dynamics and ray tracing techniques, they can find the appropriate deformation of a center of vorticity here in the western South Pacific Ocean. And then if they trace along all these lines, they could form these elongated centers with a northwest-southeast tilt. So they could attribute this deformation of the wave train toward the northeast. And they finally conclude this conceptual model where the perturbations are mostly circular in the South Pacific Ocean, and then they start to get this meridional elongation and northwest-southeast tilt as they advance towards the northeast. And also in the leading edge of this trough, you get the convection associated with the SACS, which is something similar to what Lehmann had found before. So for Southern Hemisphere summer, then this conceptual model focusing mostly in South America would be that we can have two phases of this dipole pattern. One phase where we have a weakened SACS and enhanced precipitation in the southeastern South American region. As we focus mostly in here, we will call this a positive phase of the pattern. So when precipitation is enhanced in the southeastern South America region at the leading edge of this trough that is located in the southern tip of the continent, and then you have a weakened SACS also with a characterization of an intensified low-level jet coming from here towards the central region of Argentina. And this type of pattern has been associated with extreme daily rainfall events here at the subtropics. And as opposed to that, we have a negative phase of the pattern when the SACS is the one that is enhanced here, and then it's the leading edge of the trough that's located in the southern southeastern South America region, and then precipitation is suppressed or inhibited here in the southeastern South America region. In this case, this type of pattern was related to the higher frequency of heat waves and extreme daily temperature events. The mechanism that was proposed was that the enhancement of convection here in the Sac region will produce compensatory subsidence in the subtropical region, then favorite clear skies and adiabatic heating. And when that is. Sorry, what's coming from outside. This diabatic heating produced by the compensatory subsidence here and the clear skies will produce, when it's persistent, heat waves here in the region of eastern and northern Argentina. So when we move to the southern hemisphere winter, that was not as studied as the southern hemisphere summer. By analogy, we tried to also analyze the this intraseasonal variability of OLR during winter as a proxy to the this intraseasonal variability of precipitation. And we took the first EOF of the EOF analysis in this region. And what we got in this case, you can see an intense dipole, but only one intense center following this region in southeastern South America, northern Paraguay, and southern Brazil. And we could relate that this center of activity was, it had main periods of variability between 17 and 30 to 40 days, which was similar to the PSA patterns. And also, we could relate this region as the region where the cold fronts that they come from the southwestern region, like from this region, they advance towards here, and then they tend to become stationary in this region. So that also can be affecting the variability of this region. We then perform linear lag regressions using the principal component associated to this pattern to analyze how the convection evolves, the tropical convection evolves in this season, and also the southern hemisphere circulation. So this lag regression are computed from day zero backwards up to day 10, I'm showing. And then on day zero, what you see is this is upper level geopotential height. A cyclonic anomaly here in the northern Argentina, Uruguay, and southern Brazil, which would be a bit upstream of this convection center that you could locate here in associated to the first EOF, which would be this one. And then if you see upstream, then you can see these wave drains coming from the extratropics and also from the subpolar regions, which are similar to the winter PSA patterns that I've shown before. So here, 6 days before, 8 days before, you can see also this subtropical wave train in the opposite phase of the subpolar wave train, which is divided in this region because of the splitting of the jet. So those are gas waveguides in the winter, and then you get this propagation toward the northeast in South America. As you can see, there's not a clear signal of the Madden-Julian activity or the tropical convective activity here in the tropics, as it's not the, this is June, July, August, it's not the main season of variability related in the southern hemisphere. So if we want to look at the full seasonal cycle of this variability, here I'm showing in the contours the mean OLR for the season. So here is for DJF, you see the strongest contours showing the mean position of the South Atlantic convergence zone. Then you can see it here in June, July, August, and in this transition seasons in September, October, November, it's coming from the north, and then during the austral spring, it's moving toward the northern hemisphere. And in shaded, you can see the standard deviation of the filter, intraseasonal filter OLR anomalies. And you can see that during summer, even though the mean variability, the mean sax position is here, the variability is located a bit to the north of that region, and also in location here in the southeastern South America. The variability is less intense during autumn and spring, and a bit also during spring season. But you can see also the location of the higher variability in the main region of the EOF here. And also during March, April, May, you can see quite extended here in the subtropics and tropical region. So if we perform the first EOF of these intraseasonal filtered OLR anomalies, you can see that they're mostly dipoles during the DJF, autumn and spring seasons with seasonal differences there. We are taking the 10 to 90 days variability. And during winter, then you can see only one center of action located here, as we pointed out before. We call this the seasonal intraseasonal patterns. And we could relate this to the precipitation in the southeastern South America region in the following way using the first principle components. So focus here first. This would be called the SIS index, or it's the standardized PC1 index following this EOF. So when it's positive, we name it like wet phase of the pattern from a southeastern South America point of view. So a positive index would mean that you have a negative OLR anomalies here and positive in the sacs. So the sacs would be inhibited in summer, and then the convection will be enhanced more to the south. And the opposite in the dry phase will be when the convection is enhanced in the region of more variability associated to the South Atlantic convection zone, and then it will be inhibited in the CISA region. So we took a couple of grid points in the center of action of the southeastern South America region for each of the seasons. And I'm sorry that these figures are in Spanish, but you can still see the point, I guess. This will be the frequency, and this is the duration in days of consecutive days of precipitation observing the region here pointed by the cross. So you get 2 days of consecutive rainfall above the 75th percentile in the region, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, and up to 6 days. And what we try to associate this occurrence of wet spells to the sign of this index that shows the activity of these patterns. What we could mostly see was that as these wet spells last longer, then they all tend to occur in the wet phase of this pattern. And this was more evident in the intense wet spells. So this is what it led us to use this this index that monitor these patterns to analyze the intraseasonal variability in the rainfall in the region. So the take-home messages of all this talk would be that the leading patterns intensify in the southern hemisphere circulation and which have an influence on intraseasonal timescales are the southern annual mode on one hand, and then we have the two Pacific South American patterns that have this wave train-like features that propagate in the South Pacific towards South America. Then the Mediterranean propagation condition for the Rossby wave trains change across the seasons, and they're mostly different in austral winter when we have this forbidden region for propagation around the Australian-New Zealand region associated to the speed of the wave, the jet, and then the speed of the wave trains there. The biggest driver of South American precipitation is the South American monsoon system, which main features are the South Atlantic convergence zone and this upper level Bolivian high in upper levels. Then the interseasonal variability of convection rainfall in South America is associated with a dipole pattern in summer or the wet season and then a monopole in winter. The activity of these patterns is related to the propagation of Rossby wave across the Pacific. We show different seasonal features, and mostly during winter, we've seen that they relate to the PSA patterns. And it was the activity of these patterns that could be related to the occurrence of intense wet spells in the southeastern South America region. And that is why we're going to be monitoring this activity to infer about the possibility of occurrence of this wet spell. So I left after a couple of references of all the works that I mentioned. So thank you for your time and your invitation here to the ICTP, mostly to Fred and David that organized this. Thank you.